And thank you for your patience in getting started a little bit later this evening. I'd like to welcome you to this meeting of the Churchill Club. My name is Karen Tucker, and I am the CEO of the Churchill Club as of about 8 months ago. And I just want to say that this is so fabulous to have everybody here like this tonight. It's wonderful. We did have a sold-out event, and I know that a lot of people have been stuck in traffic, but I do expect the seats to fill up eventually. And in fact, we have a room full of brilliant people, many of whom could themselves be panelists telling stories this evening. And we called that to task when Terry Takai, the CIO of the state of California, was devastated that she had to call in sick. She wasn't able to come. And so Carol Mills, who's one of Silicon Valley tech business stars, happened to be registered for the event this evening, and we asked her if she would. But before we get started, I just wanted to make a couple of announcements about our upcoming events. On Wednesday, July 30th, we present one of our most popular and fun events. It's the fifth annual Good Wine and Good Company. The theme this year is Old World Meets New World. And it will be focusing on California winemakers who are using European methods in creating their wine. It will be held at Crush Pad in San Francisco. And it is open to members only, but if you are not a member, do not fear. We do offer memberships, and you can arrange that through staff here tonight or by visiting our website. On Monday, August 4, it is Hollywood U2, Finding the Money and Eyeballs in Web Video. This all-star panel discussion will also be in San Francisco at a really gorgeous location on Howard Street. And on Tuesday, August 19, it's Upsizing, Breaking the Billion-Dollar Benchmark in Palo Alto at the Crown Plaza. So please do watch for other great programs as well, including Politics 2008, Soundbites, Spin, and The Search for the Facts on August 14, Mark Andreessen on September 4, a privacy panel on September 8, actually right here in this same facility, and Steve Ballmer on September 25th. We also have the CEO of Nokia, who's known as OPK, because people, I guess, cannot pronounce his name so easily, on October 1st. So tonight's event, the Women Tech Executive Roundtable, Cultivating Influence and Delivering Results, is the first of four programs on the theme of technology and society that is sponsored by Microsoft. And so I would ask that you please help me thank Microsoft for their generosity. And for opening their house to us tonight. Our supporting sponsor is Cisco Systems. Cisco actively leads and participates in activities to increase women's interest in tech-related careers, and so please thank Cisco with me. So I would also like to acknowledge our co-hosts this evening. Two of them, the first is the Anita Borg Institute, or ABI. And ABI focuses on recruiting, training, and retaining technical women. And they have resources and programs that provide role models, skills, and opportunities for networking and increased visibility. And in October, at the 8th Grace Hopper Celebration of Women in Computing, they will unveil a study. They have a study about barriers and facilitators, both barriers and facilitators of advancement of women in technical careers. You can visit them on the web at anitaborg.org. And our second co-host is the Forum for Women Executives and Entrepreneurs. The Forum focuses on leadership excellence for accomplished women from a wide range of disciplines and industries to build meaningful relationships, exchange ideas, and openly share their collective wisdom. On August 13, the Forum will present an evening with Nancy Pelosi discussing her new book, for Women Leaders, and on September 11, they present their annual achievement award honoring Heidi Roizen, another of Silicon Valley's prominent women leaders, and you can visit them on the web at fweande.org. And now it's my pleasure to turn over the podium to Robin Smith of Microsoft, who will introduce Anne Winblad. Thank you.
So good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to Microsoft Silicon Valley campus. My name is Robin Smith, and I am the Engineering Excellence Coordinator for the SVC campus. I'm also a lead development engineer over at Telme, a Microsoft subsidiary. Telme was acquired about a year ago, so I'm a little new to the whole Microsoft family. And I have to tell you, it's a little strange for me because I was a consultant for 15 years, and if you'd asked me if I would ever work for Microsoft, I would have told you you were smoking crack. So I have to tell you, though, it's been fabulous. I absolutely love working for Microsoft. I love the fact that Microsoft really appreciates women and diversity and that they do just fabulous things to help make everybody better, both from a community perspective by hosting these types of events, and for their employees through their training and, you know, those types of things. So it is really wonderful to be here, to have you here, and I'd really like to thank Karen and the Churchill Club and all of our panelists for giving up their time today, as well as all of you. This is a fabulous topic, and we all need to get better at it if we're going to improve our world today. I cannot tell you how wonderful it is to work for a company that believes in diversity, but what I really think is important is that you all believe the same thing. And it really means a lot to have to look out here and see that diversity in front of us. It isn't just women, it isn't just men, it's everyone. And the fact that all of you are interested in influence and getting results. Now, our lead for the topic today is Anne Winblad. Anne is a legend in our tech industry. She has done just about everything. Started out as a programmer, co-founded the Hummer Winblad Venture Partners. She's a leading venture capital firm. She's done strategy advisor, technical author, venture capitalist. Is there anything you haven't done?
A lot.
A lot. And she certainly has served as the director on a board of a number of different things. You probably could read more about it than I could tell you, and I won't take up the time. So I'd like to thank everyone for being here and thank Anne for taking us on this great journey.
Great. Well, I guess our microphones are on, so I'm honored to be the moderator of this panel tonight, and welcome, ladies, and there are some gentlemen out there, I know I can see. Women have been in the news a lot in Silicon Valley in the last few months, most notably Sheryl Sandberg leaving a prominent post at Google to join another startup, Facebook. Last week, the surprising news that Diane Greene was ousted from her job as the CEO of VMware. And just a couple days ago, Charlene announced after coming into year 10 of Forrester that she was resigning from her position, which we'll hear more about tonight. We've got three wonderful women on our panel tonight, and I'm going to ask them each to introduce themselves versus me reading their bios so you can start hearing in their voices about them. We've got a lot of topics we're going to talk about tonight, and after we get to about 8 o'clock or so, we're going to ask you to hear your voices and hear the questions you have for our panelists. So we'll start at this end with Gina, if you can introduce yourself.
Sure. My name is Gina Bianchini. I am the co-founder and CEO of Ning, which is a company that gives people the freedom to create their own social networks for anything. I co-founded the company about 3.5 years ago, and am currently overseeing about 100 people today.
And I'm Charlene Lee. I'm an analyst with Forrester Research. I have 3 more days on the job. And then I have recently announced that I am leaving to get more balance in my life. I don't necessarily believe that balance is possible, but I am going to try very hard to get to work less and spend more time with my family. And previously to Forrester, I've been there for 9.5 years, very long time, and thoroughly enjoyed it. A lot of influence, and hopefully getting some results with companies too. Talk about that later.
I'm Carol Mills. I serve on two corporate boards. I'm on the board of Adobe Systems, who you may have heard of. And I'm also on the board of Tekelec, who you may not have heard of. They're in South Carolina. They're a telecom equipment supplier. And then I'm on the board of several nonprofits. I am on boards now following a 30-plus year role, operating executive role at Hewlett-Packard, Juniper Networks, and also I was CEO of a software company.
So everybody seems really relaxed on our panel. That's not because we were drinking copious amounts of wine before we came up here. And we haven't really learned much about our panelists. I know Gina just returned from her honeymoon, and we could ask her to tell us about that. But instead of doing that, I've asked each of the panelists to describe a typical day in their life. Why don't we start with you, Charlene?
Well, it's usually running around trying to get my kids off to school, and it's total chaos. But my kids are 8 and 9 years old, and what's interesting is I usually am talking to many, many companies throughout the day. They usually come in and brief me, usually half an hour, 45-minute briefings, where a company like Ning will come in and talk to me about what they're doing. And then I will talk to clients all day long about what people like Ning are doing and making recommendations. I talk to press a tremendous amount. Over the years, I've developed very good press relationships with people throughout the industry. And then I do a lot of public speaking and a great deal of research along the way. So a lot of reading, writing on blogs, writing reports.
A book?
I wrote a book somewhere along the way too. Promote the book, go on book tours. And I think this week, in 5 days, I'm giving 6 speeches.
So what time do you start in the morning? What time do you get home at night?
I usually work about 45 hours a week, consistently. And it's hard. It's really, really hard. But I also know that if I go over that, my kids, my family just starts falling apart at the seams.
So I can see that Gina's saying, gee, 45 hours a week, that would be great. What's a day in your life as a CEO of a young, growing company?
I am typically in the office by about 7:15, 7:30 at the latest. I love getting in early because it basically, especially in an engineering-driven culture, people don't start rolling in until around 9 or later at times. But I love getting in early. I love sort of seeing kind of what happened overnight. So, you know, looking at our numbers, looking at the results, checking. We have a social network for the people who are our customers or people who are creating social networks on Ning. So checking out kind of what are the issues, what's going on, catching up certainly ahead of the day starting in email. 9:15, we have a all-hands meeting. I should actually mention, too, between 7:15 and 9:15, I typically have like 2 cups of coffee. You know, just kind of getting ready for what's going to be upon
That's not
me.
Your total food for the day, though.
Oh, no. And I've actually started eating breakfast, and it's made a huge difference. I wasn't eating breakfast before, and then I started to, and I have so much more energy throughout the day. So I don't, you know, I'm not advocating breakfast for people. I don't want to be one of those breakfast Nazis. But at the same time, it's really helped me a lot. So then we have an all-hands meeting at 9:15, so it's a standing meeting. We meet for 15 minutes, and then I sort of figure out what I need to do that day. So I typically have people running into my office, generally speaking, not with their hair on fire, thankfully. But you know, I have one-on-one meetings with my direct reports, team meetings in terms of what we're doing, what's coming up. I'm also, you know, continually staying up on email throughout the day, and then, you know, try to carve out some time for a project. So, you know, it may be looking through, you know, defining a new feature. It may be looking through and playing around with something that I think we should improve, helping the company set priorities. But it's sort of a lot of people, email and electronic work in front of my computer, and then also trying to carve out project time. And if I don't get to it during the day, I typically go eat by myself at a sushi restaurant in Menlo Park because I really like the sort of peace and quiet and routine of eating at the same sushi restaurant in approximately 10 minutes. And then I go back to the office, and then that's when I would sort of do my project work. But sadly, that's kind of a typical day. I just told you guys all that I eat by myself most nights and sort of enjoy it. I don't know what that says about me. But then I typically leave the office between, you know, call it 9 and 12, because that's what I really like. I really like the quiet time where I can actually get ahead of the day. I work most Sundays, and I leave sort of somewhat early on Friday, in part because as CEO, I want to make sure that we're ready to go for the next week. So I actually find the time to sort of organize the week ahead and use that time where I'm not in meetings and I'm not sort of doing things to sort of set the goals for the week, what we're trying to accomplish, and then by Friday afternoon, I'm totally fried.
Does your husband know about these 70-hour work weeks yet?
You know, he does. He does. He works hard, too.
Because I calculated the hours, and it came up to about 70.
Yeah, yeah. I started my career as an investment banker analyst, which basically is the lowest person on the totem pole, that they basically had you work very, very long hours. So, I love what I do. I love it a lot more than investment banking. So, there are many times when it doesn't feel like work.
So, Carol, you're further along in your career. You're probably remembering your early days at HP.
Yes.
So now that you, do you have more control of your work hours? Is it more than 45, less than 45? Can you top 70?
Her description is what my life was like for, 30 plus years before I stopped. and now, I deliberately moved from that, heads down lifestyle about maybe 3 years ago, 2.5 years ago, to have more time for myself. What I found was that I loved what I did. I absolutely loved what I did, so I completely understand what you're talking about. But what I found was I was so occupied with the specific industry, the specific technology, the specific customer set, that I lost perspective on what was kind of going around on in the world at large. And I like the feeling that I have when I'm on boards of being broader. What you lose when you're on boards and you're broader is you lose that attachment to the deep attachment. But I was willing, after 30 years of that, I was willing to do to give that up for more time. My work week is incredibly varied. It's the first time I've ever worked out of my home, which has good things and bad things about it. I can spend all day in my jammies if I want to. Sometimes on the phone, of course, the neighbors think you're a little odd at 4 o'clock in the afternoon if you go out and pick up the mail and you're still in your jammies. But they've gotten kind of I've lived in the same house for 25 years, so my neighbors have lived with me through the other work weeks. So they used to tell me when school holidays were, because I would take my children to school on holidays. Oh, Carol, today's a holiday. Don't take your kids to school. Or your front door's open. One time I had a neighbor call me and say, your front door's open. You want me to close it for you? So I was kind of a wacky neighbor. And I've gone from being one of those people who couldn't believe that people actually had time to shop during the day. You'd go out and you think, who is this person that they're shopping? And now I'm like one of those people. Like, oh my God. So it's very, very different. Boards have 4 in-person meetings a year, usually 2 or 3 day meetings. And so you can kind of, on 2 boards, that's not that many in-person meetings, except for that I chair 2 comp committees. And that's, adds to, it probably doubles or triples or quadruples the amount of commitment that one has. And that's a lot of fun because it's, it's something that, I lead and I run for on behalf of the board. I also got to chair the succession planning committee, the nominating and governance committee for Adobe while there was a CEO succession. So that was a very challenging and different kind of thing. So that I have a very different kind of work week, but it leaves me time to chair a nonprofit and get involved in other things. So
let's now that we know that we have 3 Type A's on this panel, Gina, would you say that your CEO job is typical, the 70-hour work week, the kind of commitment that you have to make, talking to your peers that you're not out of whack here, that this is what it takes to be a CEO of a young company?
Yes. Absolutely. And in fact, you know, I was at a conference last week with a few other CEOs of sort of younger internet companies, and you know, there were a few moments where I was like, I don't work enough. Like relative to these other guys that were, you know, certainly talking about, you know, I would also say in sort of a romanticized bravado of, you know, I pull 18-hour days every single day, which, by the way, cannot possibly be true. So there's a little bit of that, but at the same time, you know, I do believe when it is a 24-hour a day, 7-day a week service and business, that, you know, the good news and the bad news is that, you know, the good news is that it sort of keeps working while you sleep. The bad news is, you know, stuff can pop up at any time. And, you know, being available, being kind of engaged, and making very quick decisions really, you know, around the clock is, I think, one of the realities of leading and leadership in kind of the internet world in 2008.
So Carol's name comes up quite often when we're doing CEO recruitment in the venture circuit. And so we were always having recruiters tap Carol and say, don't you want to be a CEO? And I know one of the divisions Carol ran at HP was a $6.5 billion division. I believe you job shared that?
At the end, last year.
So, you know, have you ever aspired to be a CEO?
Well, I was CEO of a software startup for 4 years when we were acquired in 2002, so I completely understand. Even though the responsibility was monetarily much smaller because my company only got to a $30 million run rate, and it was a rounding error in my old business. The funniest moment that I ever had is when I left HP, which was about $6.5 billion, and I looked at my P&L as a software company, because I wasn't the founding CEO, I was the hired-in CEO. I looked at it and I started to laugh. I put my head down on the table, I laughed. I said, oh my God, my entire company is a rounding error in my previous R&D budget. So it was a really, really, really different scale. But that doesn't change the time commitment, it doesn't change the sense of responsibility. It just, you know, it's just a different mix, but that same commitment, maybe it is the type A thing that you're talking about, but it's all encompassing.
Yeah.
So Charlene, let's talk about some of the gender issues. You're a petite Japanese woman. Asian woman, there we go. You know, you're not exactly out of central casting. And your job, I've seen you before, you have to command the room, you have to be the influencer, set the trends. You know, describe how you entered the technology industry and how you got to such a role of influence.
Well, first of all, when I came out of undergrad, I was not a confident speaker. I really had to work at it. I got some great advice early on in my career that not to up-talk in everything that I did. And then also just to speak with a lower tone of voice, actually. So I'm an alto anyways, but just like really have a certain gravitas. And then when I decided to go to business school, I really, really wanted to come to Stanford. So I wanted to live in California. I was sick of the cold weather. But then I went and visited Harvard, and I realized that the emphasis there was what I needed, which was to be able to express myself clearly and succinctly among my peers, and very competitive peers too, every single day, every single minute. And so that was great training, that I could come out and know that in any business situation, I could hold my own, any business situation. And so that gave me the confidence to go out there and do that speaking. It also made me do something called making the call. Oftentimes when people go, well, what do you think about something? So many people, well, it could be this, it could be that. And so from a very early part of my career, it was put your stake in the ground and stand on it. And stand on it firmly, and don't waver from that. And so I don't always give an answer really quickly. I'll take my time to figure out what I want to say, especially when a press person calls and says, what do you think of this happening? I'm like, I hadn't heard that. And it's perfectly fine to be able to hear the situation and be able to react to it. But it's making the call and then be able to say very clearly and succinctly what you think.
And did you ever feel there was a boys' club that you weren't part of or that you wanted to be part of?
Yes, when I was in business school, it happens actually a lot. In business school, I was applying to interview into VCs, and they had two schedules, and all the schedules were filled by men. There was not a single woman on the schedule. And so in interviewing into certain groups where you just know people feel very comfortable, I don't think it's intentional, but people feel really comfortable really talking to people who are like themselves. So I think your point about diversity, forcing yourself to look for diversity, to look for the difference of opinion, to look for the differences is hard. Oftentimes I will walk into publishing houses, technology places where it's a bunch of guys in white shirts, and I'm the only person who looks anywhere even different to them. And I just make sure that if it's a cocktail party, we sit down as quickly as possible so we're on the same, you know, eye-to-eye level. I make sure that I do stand out even more. I try to not conform to anything. When I go to cocktail parties and networking places, I wear bright colors, like bright purple or striped shirt or something, so people can see where I am and know, oh, that's Charlene over there with the big red purse. Go talk to her. Bright pink. I'll stand by, you know, places, just intentionally stand out. And that's really helped a lot in the industry I'm in.
Now, Gina, you have a new place in Central Casting. You're the it girl of Silicon Valley now. So, you know, we've seen several other women CEOs in Silicon Valley disappear, most notably the Katrina Garnett black dress episode that many of us in the room remember. So how do you handle being glamorized along with your success?
And for just as context, I was on a cover of a magazine that it actually had a great article about my company, but it definitely had a moment where I was like, oh shit, because I'm not a very glamorous person, and certainly, you know, at the same time, it was a tremendous opportunity, a tremendous article and a tremendous thing for our company. Fundamentally, my belief is that the most important thing that I can spend my time doing, and that what matters in 2008, and really at any point in time, is results. And I think especially for people who don't look or sound or are the same color or have the same interests as people that are directly out of, you know, nerd central casting in, you know, in the sort of Silicon Valley world, or, you know, something else in the entertainment world or something else in, you know, the finance world, that the thing that matters is results. So my belief is that, you know, certainly getting press for our company, I want it to be because of what we're doing. And I believe fundamentally that that's what we're doing. And at the end of the day, the reason why most people in this room remember that picture but not the woman or not the company is because they didn't produce anything that was really meaningful or valuable. So I personally don't care about that kind of press. It's not how I value myself. It's not how I look at, you know, what is my own personal identity. The thing that I care the most about and what motivates me to work the kinds of weeks that I work is, one, I love what my company is doing. And I fundamentally believe that it's making the world a better place. And second, at the end of the day, if we produce results, no one's going to remember the cover. They're going to remember the results. And it doesn't matter what I look like. It doesn't matter what my background is. I'm not an engineer by training. But it's about results, and it's about the product, and it's about the team. It's about the company. And it's not about me. So I don't know if I answered your question, but it...
You did. Okay. So, Carol, we came in under nerd cover because we both started our careers as programmers. So we came in with the nerd cast a long time ago. So being nerdulent is a compliment, by the way, in this valley.
Use it as such, by the way.
Yeah. Do you think there's a new guard of women entering the IT industry? And there are more expanded roles of entry point for women to start careers that they can grow in?
Yeah, I think there's entry points all over the place now. I mean, I think there's entry points as, you know, as backgrounds like yours for CEOs, there's still entry points for technical women. So I think it's broadened a lot. I'm hesitating because I'm thinking about your comment, and I kind of am trying not to respond, and I think I'm going to lose that battle.
Oh, respond. Respond.
Because I think you were saying about how that what it really comes down to, is this okay?
Yeah, sure.
What it really comes down to is
you
is,
can say anything.
Is results.
We're happy to have
and,
you.
And I really agree with you, except that I think that that you ought to take the advantage that you have, whatever it is, and run with it. Because tilt the plane. If the playing field is tilted because you have a great picture on the front cover, go for it and take that advantage and add to it your results. Because another company that has the same kind of results, if you have some kind of advantage, that's going to make you further. And if it's whatever it is, you have to seize that advantage. And I used to believe much more in the results will speak for itself, and that's the nerd background. Just keep my feet going one, step after another. And if you can get some unfair advantage, you ought to just seize it for whatever it is.
So one of the descriptions of the set of our session tonight is, what is leadership? And so I'm going to ask you all that question. What is the definition of leadership in 2008 and beyond? You want to start, Charlene?
It's interesting because we take a course in business school, influence and control. And control is the typical kind of influence of leadership that you have, that you are heading an organization and you have all these people reporting to you, and that's leadership. You would tell them to go march in this direction and they will march. They never march in that direction. It's really about influence in the end that gives you the control. And so I feel that what I realized early on in my career is that I was really good at managing people and I hated it. I hated being that leader kind of type thing, and I'm much more comfortable with the influence side of things. And so my influence is in the influence of ideas. And so there's many ways you can express leadership. It can be, again, a very visible position. It can be by leadership by example, leadership in terms of the community, by just being, by through action and the results that you can create. But also the area that I've been really exercising is in the area of influence and ideas. And so everything that I've done has been around ideas, and it's amazing how much leadership you can exercise never, ever having control.
Carol?
I'm intrigued by your saying that at HBS it's leadership, was it?
It was influence and control.
And control. And when I was there, it was power and influence. So that kind of shows the difference in ages. I don't think that there is... so much exercise, there's can be raw exercise of power, but I don't think that's the kind of the modern way of thinking about it. I think it really is how do you amass influence through a track record and through your own, wisdom. I have enjoyed, running organizations and being the leader, and what I've found is that people... there's a large group of people that want to follow someone they have confidence in. They have confidence is going to make the right calls and has a track record of following through and caring about the organization. And so I think that the more you establish that, the more fun you get to perpetuate that, continuing to lead, continuing to influence, continuing to set the charge and set the path. And there's nothing more rewarding, in my experience, is to set a course, follow through on it, and then look back and see what you've achieved, and then take the next hill. It's just a kick. So
Gina, what's on the job learning of a CEO like today, and what have you learned so far in what leadership means at Ning?
My definition of leadership in 2008 is, first of all, doing something and being able to synthesize the mission of the company or your team or even you into something that you're incredibly passionate about. Because, and I believe especially as a woman, there are times when leadership and management are not that cool, in the sense that you have to have difficult conversations with someone. You're not always going to be liked, and in fact, it's a gender stereotype, but it certainly applies to me, where so much of what I've ever done in my life as a woman has been to be liked. Leadership is not necessarily about being liked. And in fact, I was at this conference and I heard this woman speak this past week who, if you guys have not seen her, she is amazing. Her name is Michelle Rhee. She is the chancellor of the DC school systems. She's 37 years old. She's never had a leadership role. She's never been a chancellor of any school district, let alone the worst school district in the country. And she has taken on the teachers' unions. She has taken on, she has fired teachers. She has closed 23 schools in Washington, D.C. And I was as she was up there talking, I was trying to sit there and figure out, how can she have a smile on her face while literally there are people that are picketing outside her door every single day because what she's doing is incredibly unpopular. And it hit me that what motivates her, and you could tell, and it was, if watch a YouTube video of her, there was a great Jim Lehrer special that they did on her, and she's amazing. But she's so passionate about what she's doing, it doesn't matter that she's not going to be liked or that she's going to have to make tough calls and tough choices and that she hasn't done it before because she believes in what she's doing and she's using that strength to create the kind of infrastructure and the kind of company and really be a leader. In no way, shape, or form am I doing anything that cool in my own job, but I do find that using that sort of strength of passion that I have personally for what we're doing allows everything to get easier. It allows me to have conversations with people that, it's really coming from a place of we're all in this together, and these are the areas that you can get even better. And also, I would say, in terms of on-the-job training, the single biggest change that I made in my career, it took me a little while, as a type A person, where it's like I always wanted to be right, or I always wanted to like do a great job. And so when people gave me feedback on things that I could do better, it was like, well, that must mean I'm not doing well in all of these other things. And when I actually just relaxed and was like, okay, I'm not perfect. I'm going to make mistakes all the time. Failure is a part of leadership. How you bounce back from it and what you do with things that aren't necessarily going your way is really where a leader is made or broken. And once all that sort of, once I got cool with that, it actually made it so much more fun. It allowed me to be so much more productive. And, at the end of the day, taking, what you're passionate about, synthesizing it into something that is clear and specific and really allows people to rally around it. I've just, it's made going from, literally zero employees where it was like me at a desk for the first, few months of Ning's life to 100 people, it just, you have to keep with the clear message and accept failure, figure out what the lesson that you're supposed to learn from it and move forward. But, I at least have found for myself, and I don't know if it resonates with any of you guys, but, when I'm passionate about the right, what I believe is the right thing to do, whether that's a product thing or whether that's an organizational thing, that sort of strength and ability to sort of synthesize it down makes the whole thing work.
So let's talk about something that's very unique to women's career paths, maternity leave. Charlene?
Yeah, I joined Forrester with a 3-month-old, and then after 9 months, left again for another maternity leave. And it was interesting, 2 weeks before I left, they gave me a promotion to management. And then I said, look, I'm kind of pregnant, I need to leave. And they said, we're going to hold the position open for you for 4 months and then come back. And I said, but I'm coming back part-time. They said, that's fine, we'll make it work. And so I was just shocked by that. And what was interesting, it was hard because I was thinking, my gosh, I'm leaving the tech industry for 4 months and I'm going away to have baby brains, basically. And I was worried that I would come back and sort of be behind it, be lost, my clients would forget me. And we were talking about this, they kind of just waited. And the industry was fine, I came back, picked up where I was. What was interesting was, first of all, realizing that I wasn't that essential, at the same time realizing that the world does go on and it was okay. And that experience actually gave me a lot of confidence to say I could take a next move and feel confident that everything would be okay, that I could make these kinds of transitions.
I had an amazingly parallel experience. I had two children at 18 months apart. So the first time you go out, everybody goes, how are we possibly going to, you know, exist without you, you know, all these problems, and who's going to solve these, blah, 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 blah. And then you come back, and the problems have all waited. Nobody solved them, so they can't have been that critical. And you get a little cynical, and you say, I'm not going to get so hyped up about this problem, because it was just perfectly happy to, you know, wait for 3 months without me. And the second time, I was also promoted right before I left, or holding the promotion. And I'm not sure if it was a bribe to come make sure we came back or not. But it was very flattering. I had really no intention of going anywhere else because I wanted to take full advantage of, you know, whatever flexibility I could wring out of HP at the time. I was extremely happy to come back, though. I remember the first day I came back, I thought, oh, my God, it's so safe here. If somebody stabs themselves with a pencil, it's not my fault. It's not my problem. You know, nobody's going to electrocute themselves. It was just such a safe environment. I was so happy.
Two kids.
I know. I was so happy to be
back
as an adult.
Yeah.
It's wonderful.
So you've just resigned from your job at Forrester, and we've described the unsafe world you're going to enter on the 18th of July. Talk about that decision and what the future holds for you. You're still very young in your career.
Yeah, Forrester is a great place. The fact that I stayed there for 9.5 years is a testament to that. And I always have subscribed to the career advice that I subscribed to myself was, you have to find a new job every 18 months. Well, I had new challenges inside my job at Forrester every 18 months. I made sure that I created them too. This is a fantastic place to work. But what I realized was that I needed a type of control that Forrester just couldn't give me. And they did everything possible to give me that flexibility. In the end, it's really hard to say no to 2,000 clients. And it's just really hard, really hard to be able to say no to them and prioritize your family when you're working for a company. And I said, the only way I'm going to do this is if I leave and really prioritize my family, make work fit inside a container of 6 or 7 hours a day and travel twice a month. So when I figured that out, I read two books. I read 4-Hour Work Week about a year ago. I went, 4 hours a week? And I talked to Tim Ferriss, who goes, okay, it's not really 4 hours. He works quite a bit more than that. But the other thing, too, I read recently that pushed me over the edge was Maria Shriver's book, Who Will You Be? And that really struck me, and I said, I have to be true to myself first, and that gave me the courage. And what happened was so easy, especially in a high-status job like Forrester, where you have all this external feedback coming to you. You're great, you're giving great advice, lots of people press, you know, 60 minutes, everything. And then you go, how can I leave that? And what I realized was the definition of success was external. I needed to define what my success was going to be. And my success is a balance, again, of what I do with my family and also what I can do with work. And the really scary thing now is, how can I maintain my influence working significantly, not hugely, not less, but can I maintain that level of influence that I really like and enjoy, the things I love about my job, in this new constraint?
So recently, Bill Gates retired after 33 years at Microsoft. I was at one of his retirement parties, and he proudly proclaimed he never even had a sick day. So we've had some departures from our industry that are prominent and successful women. Meg Whitman announced after 10 years she was going to retire as the CEO of eBay. Carol Bartz had a lot longer tenure at Autodesk. Carol, you've been doing this for 30 years. You said 9.5, like it was a huge period of time. And Ning is how many years old?
We are 3.5 years old.
So Gina, if 30 years from now, do you think you could still be doing the same job? How do you view longevity and really the long roadmap of your career?
I don't really think about it.
It's a scary thought.
Yeah, and not for sort of any really good reason, but for me, you know, just even sort of going back and thinking and talking about sort of job security, you know, I think a lot of, and just the technology industry, I don't think I would have my job right now if I didn't start the company. And I think that there is something to be said about that. And I think there's a ton of different factors kind of involved in this, but it was very clear to me when we started Ning, and certainly even before that, that unless I co-founded something with a partner that believed in me, I was not going to be a CEO. And in fact, you know, again, in part because the way you look and backgrounds and things like that, whenever I talked to sort of VCs or mentors or people that I knew, it was like, oh, we'll make you, you know, an advertising manager somewhere. When it's like, okay, that's great, because my background's in advertising and finance, and nothing wrong with advertising managers, but it was kind of pushing me into, you know, no, you don't want to be a CEO. Like CEO, being a CEO is hard, and by the way, it is. I mean, there's no question about that, but I have to be candid and forthright and say that, you know, on some level, my path to becoming a CEO was made easier because I started it, and I started with one person, myself, with my co-founder who believed in me, and I have been incredibly fortunate for that purpose. So I don't really sort of think about sort of 30 years because that just seems, you know, really far away. But, you know, was it...
It goes fast.
I know. And that, I actually was thinking about that this week where I was like, it's already Tuesday? And it just seemed like everything had sort of flown by much faster. But, you know, the things that are important to me are, you know, fully realizing the true potential of the company that, you know, myself and my co-founder started, and that the team that we have on the team is able to really fully see through what the opportunity is in front of us. And I hope that that opportunity is something that, you know, both continues to have challenges that are new. Right now it seems like new challenges show up either every day or every week that requires change and, you know, adaptation. But, you know, I also have to figure out, I'm 36, you know, at some point, if I don't figure out kind of how you are CEO and you do maternity leave, you know, I will not be able to do something that I very much want to, which is to have a family as well. So, you know, there's all sorts of things that there isn't necessarily a great roadmap for. So my focus and sort of thought process is, okay, first we'll get through the next, like, 3 years, and then I'll worry about the next, you know, 27.
So quickly, when you joined Forrester, did you have a career plan for the next 10 years?
I didn't, and I just want to comment on that, too. I thought I was going to join Forrester for 2 years, take time off, have kids, have a relaxing kind of lifestyle as an analyst, and then go back into industry. And I loved it, and it was a great fit for me. The interesting thing I find is looking at some of my classmates from HBS, and easily half of them are not working today. And there's a very interesting question that they have. They have, I can't remember the name of the course, but it's about how do you feel comfortable leaving the industry because that's the right thing for you to do as a person and for your family, and then how do you come back? And that's a really tough thing that not only women are thinking about, but a lot of men are thinking. If you think it's hard for women, it's even harder for male counterparts to step away. Because people are like, what are you? Not a guy to, you know, do this. And so my business school roommate was the CEO of a startup, Handango, down in Dallas, away from family, down there by herself, and had 3 kids in the course of being a CEO. And I don't know how she did it. She had them like about 20 months apart, all 3 of them. So I'm thinking, yeah, you should talk to her. But it's one of the, and now she's not, and now working, she's just doing on boards, and she has a successful startup. But it's hard, because she struggles every day about her identity and what she is and who she is, because she's been so driven. And it's something that I think every single woman has thought about.
I should add one thing, though. The fact, you know, I don't look at, you know, sort of family and what I'm doing now versus, you know, having a family and how that's all going to work. I find it incredibly motivating to do one thing, hopefully very well, which is to hire world-class executives to work for the company and to build it out. Because I want to be able to have something happen to me, you know, God forbid, but, you know, to have something happen where I could step away. And therefore, I'm probably the most motivated CEO and co-founder in the entire world to get fantastic people covering and really building out the team and, you know, continually getting more and more productive. So, you know, working on Sundays becomes not working on Sundays and things along those lines. So I have no idea if I'm going to be able to pull it off, but I do find that it's actually been a constructive and healthy thing for our company right now, in the sense of really sort of motivating, not that I wanted to work with people that, you know, weren't really passionate about what they were doing or things like that, but it does add that extra motivation to make sure that it's a company and a product and everything that can sustain itself.
So we're going to go to Q&A in 1 minute after each of you tells what is the worst and best advice you've been given as far as your careers. And you don't have to give attribution if you don't want. Charlene?
The best thing was the 18 months. Look for a new challenge every 18 months. Because it's hard to think 5 years or 30 years out. You can think 18 months ahead of time. And if you can't expect that opportunity is going to be handed to you, so you have to make those opportunities. The worst advice I got was to change my name from L-I to L-E-E, because everybody would misspell my name. So that was the worst advice.
Carol.
The best advice I got was to be yourself, figure out your own strengths and kind of go with your strengths and have faith in what you were good at and that sort of thing. And the worst advice I got was to be yourself and sort of relax in your weaknesses. You know, it's kind of implicit of go with your strengths and it's okay to have weaknesses. I think you have to be really conscious that, you know, if you've got a weakness that is a glaring weakness going to cause problems for yourself, you really have to work on that. So relaxing into your weaknesses, that was like the worst advice I ever got.
For me, I said it actually earlier, which is, you know, take feedback as a positive thing that someone wants you to get better. And someone's on your team, and they wouldn't be sharing feedback with you if they thought that you were doing something wrong as opposed to something that you could get better. And I was trying to think about the worst piece of advice that I've gotten, and I don't have a good one-liner for that. I kind of wish I did.
Well, I will give you my worst advice. So the first year that I was the CEO of my young company, I gave a speech in Southern California to all of our resellers, all men. The podium was taller than me, so I had to stand on a crate to speak. And I clearly was not speaking as powerful as I could. So the CEO of the hardware company said, "We're going to take a break now." He said, "I have a few words of advice for you. If you want to run with the big dogs, you better learn how to lift your leg." I did not take it.
Yuck. Wow.
Anyway, on that note, we will go to Q&A. So questions for our panelists.
Oh, hi. I'm Terry Watts, and I have a question for Gina. As a first-time CEO, what's it like dealing with your board?
So I'm in a little bit of a unique situation because my board is myself and my co-founder. And that is very, very rare. Now, that being said, prior to Ning, I had co-founded another company where we had a much larger board. And, you know, from my perspective, the hardest thing in dealing with kind of having had the experience of sort of the outside board versus a very insular board — we have board observers, so just to be clear, it's not just myself and my co-founder that are there and present. But the challenge I saw with an outside board is that they're just coming into your business like every, you know, quarter, I know, I shouldn't, you guys, no, I should. But it's, you know, right. And so it's great in terms of the preparation and that organization for a board meeting to sort of, you know, take a step out of the day-to-day of the business, and I think that that's the benefit. The challenge is that, you know, it's hard to make sort of rapid decisions if there are rapid board decisions that need to be made, because you're educating as well as trying to get, you know, the right decision made and the right decision being defined as, you know, as broadly as possible. So it was important to me in starting Ning, and I had the great fortune to be able to do this, which I totally recognize as rare, to keep the board as small as possible and so that we could make decisions as rapidly as possible. So I like that. I think the biggest piece of advice that I would necessarily give about outside board members is that it's this fine line where it's like, if you're looking to your board for too much, there might be something wrong in terms of the management team or your idea or kind of what you're doing. And if you're not looking to them for anything, then you're not taking advantage of the great experience that someone like Anne or someone like Carol has. So I don't know if that is helpful.
Next question.
My name is Natalie Kilner. I'm a CEO of a software company. I am a founder of that company as well. And I'd like to talk to you guys about your perspective on giving women leadership opportunities. We've all, as women in executive roles, have struggled. So what advice do you give us who can hire those women to give our next generation more opportunities than we had?
One of the things I do a lot of is I see a lot of, well, I wish more women CEOs, and every time I see, and it's rare, it's unfortunately all too often rare. So when I see them, I take them aside, and I never do this with most of the vendors coming in. I take them aside and go, you hang in there. I'm there, and I'm watching. Anything I can do to help you outside of the relationship with Forrester, please let me know. And I extend that across the board. I mean, we have talked quite a bit too.
I only speak on panels that Charlene is on. It's like if Charlene's on, it's like, oh yeah, I'm there. That's cool.
And so the other thing is, you gotta nurture the, I mean, you hear all this all the time. You gotta nurture the next generation. And so I spend a tremendous amount of time with the people I work with, people I come across at colleges. I was at Google recently with the Asian American network there. Just doing a lot of just sharing of information. I've done that throughout my career. I just think it's so important that we hang in there for each other.
I would answer it in two ways. One, I'm passionate about giving constructive, honest feedback to younger women who work for me. And hiring people, and especially women where that's a good thing and that's viewed as a good thing. I really wish, you know, earlier in my career, and I think sometimes the men that I worked for early in my career were afraid to give me feedback because they were afraid like I was going to cry or something. I'm not joking. I mean, it's. I think there are a lot of men. And now managing men who manage women, I have women executives too at the company that are doing a phenomenal job. But I actually think the most important thing that I can do as a female CEO is ensure that the subtle stuff that happens, where it's like, oh, these five guys and, you know, one woman engineer, you know, the woman engineer, you know, isn't doing as well as the male engineer. Being on that, like, you know, as quickly as possible to understand what the heck is going on and make sure that it's not gender related, that it's not something that is, you know, because there is a small group of women or any other minority, that it's because of those reasons, but really about performance. So especially as we're getting bigger, my antenna for those kinds of things that are happening outside of my direct feedback or direct mentorship, I want to pay attention to those things and continue to pay attention to those things, because, you know, while I don't know if anybody has seen the show Mad Men or watched it, I mean, that makes me feel like the stuff that is happening today, it's like, oh my gosh, you know, I have nothing to complain about. But in all seriousness, the things that happen from a gender perspective or, you know, minority perspective are the subtle things that people at times don't even realize that they're doing. And that's why I actually think it's really important to have a balance of women executives and male executives, and making sure that I'm paying attention to just those subtle things that, having worked for men and worked on other places and things like that. So I actually think it's more than mentorship. It's also making sure that if you are a woman in a position of power, that you are paying attention to those things that might otherwise get lost.
I think we have a responsibility to each other to help help us advance in a couple of ways. One of the things that I do is, since when you're on a board, you're not really part of the political structure or the day-to-day life of the company, so it's easier for me to step in and do a little tiny bit of coaching when I see one of the executives, and I kind of pay more attention to the women executives than I do to the male executives, because I have a responsibility there, and they don't always get coaching. I mean, lots of executives really never get that kind of feedback or coaching, so that's appreciated if kind of done in the right way. And then I also find that board members get really little feedback on their role on boards. When you come into a board, you're supposed to already kind of know everything about what you're supposed to be doing, and you don't always really know how a board is supposed to operate. And so I've formed a network of women on boards as a peer coaching network, of getting together and talking about what an effective board member is, with the idea of making ourselves as a group more effective. So it's kind of a combination of peer exchanges of, what are our responsibility, what are our actions, peer exchanges of helping each other, and also coaching women in, lower positions. So it's not a formal thing. I think it's something you have to do every single day in small ways.
Yeah, I think that's the most important thing that the panelist is saying here, is that it doesn't have to be something big, but it should be something. And just attention to the details of what it means to be a woman in a male-dominated industry that's not going to change anytime soon. So, we can all play a very small role that has big results in helping people along with their careers. Someone's got a mic here.
Jean-Baptiste Su with the French News Agency. So just to follow up on what you said, Anne. So yesterday I was at the Intel press conference where a VP was announcing a new chip, and he was making all those funny but very sexist joke about his wife, making it not appear very in a good light. So and then when I asked questions to women in the room, also in a high tech field, they were saying, well, it's a man's world, so nothing really to do about we can do about it. So what do you think should be done to change that? I mean, in a lot of presentation, especially from the press, and there was the who's who of the business press yesterday, there's a lot of comments and referring to wives and before it was mothers, now it's wives. So that's what my first question. The second question, maybe about glass ceiling. Have you felt in your career that you have reached maybe a top and you could not go over that?
Well, I'll answer your first question because it was directed at me. And it was unfortunate that whoever that woman was did not call the gentleman on that behavior. Because that kind of stuff goes on all the time, and it will keep going on unless somebody says stop, or that, that is not a good comment. And that's another thing that women have to be confident enough, is to call bad behavior, whether it's on the part of other women or men or whatever, but it will keep proliferating unless someone says
you know, come on, that is really a rude comment, or that is not very professional. Because if it's not called, you know, and people just sit silently, you know, even, you know, in my partnership, I have all male partners, and, you know, we'll sit around on Mondays at the start of our partners meeting, and someone will start talking about what they did in the weekend, and it might gravitate towards, you know, locker room talk. And I call on that. And, you know, actually, whenever I do, my partners appreciate that. Because, you know, they've hung around with their guy friends over the weekend, and that, you know, they need to know that there's a different level of professionalism when they're working with peers that are outstanding women in the room.
When I went on maternity leave, all the guy analysts sort of got out of control, and the younger women who were on the support staff said, please come back, it's turned into a locker room. And, you know, it's one of those things, and it was one of the few times when I actually came back from maternity to sort of like rein them in and said, look, this is not a respectful work environment. My pet peeve in terms of language, and I think it's sometimes very overt like that, it just should be called, because that's a form of leadership, it's a type of courage that you have to exercise. I think we can all exercise that. But it's also very subtle, I think, as you were saying. My pet peeve is the term, oh, he's a good guy. And I'm like, what does it take to be a good guy? Because I want to be one of those people. Because they always say, you know, you should work with this person. He's a good guy. You should work with him. He's a good guy. I go, I want someone to say that about me. But I don't know what that language would be. But everyone kind of knows what that is. And that's, you hear that constantly all the time. And so I call people on it. I call people on it all the time. It's a subtle, subtle use of language. But it's a very important one to call on.
I think you have to pick your battles. I think if you jump on everybody for every term, you marginalize the effectiveness. So you have to pick your battles, and I think humor also helps a lot. And it also helps as I get older. It somehow as it gets easier, you know, to just be crotchety old lady. And I, you know, I didn't anticipate that.
You're not doing any slapping or anything like that yet, are you?
Maybe that'll come next. but humor and, you know, slight humiliation in the humor really goes a long way.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have to kind of rehearse it because you know that if those comments come out, you know that they're going to come out again. So if you're like, I'm not always very quick on my feet, so sometimes I'll kind of like rehearse a comment. Thinking, that will be good in that. And, you know, and sure enough, the situation comes around and you can use it and it can be effective.
One of my favorite lines, because I'm very short, is when people meet me the first time, they frequently say, I thought you would be bigger. And I always answer, where?
That's hilarious.
My name is Diana, and I noticed on your speech you talked a lot about passion, about loving what you do. Seems like you guys all know what you want to do. What if I know what I don't like, but I have no clue what I want?
Keep trying things. And be very clear with what you don't want. I mean, one of the most powerful tools I have found in terms of product definition, and I spend a lot of my time sort of defining, you know, what our product is and where it's going, is the things that we're not doing. And, you know, in fact, it makes things a lot clearer when you know what you're not going to do in an upcoming release as much as what you are going to do. And it makes what you are going to do clearer at times when you are sort of, you know, clearing off the stuff that you know you don't. So, you know, I think the same applies in terms of either, you know, career path or just happiness as a person, you know, defining the things that you don't like. I don't like to travel, so I have a job that I don't really have to travel, and I want to make sure that I don't have to travel for work. That's important to me. So, you know, knowing those kinds of things, at least in my experience, makes it so much easier to find the things that you do have passion for and that are important to you.
And I would take full advantage of any informational interview ability that you can put together. Use it for a networking But tell, ask people what they like about their jobs and what they don't like about their jobs, what they would do differently. What is, you know, what do they like about the way that they spend their day? Because then you can sort of say, am I like that or am I not like that? And you're not interviewing for a job, you're not doing the job. People love to talk about their, you know, their jobs and why they selected it. They're, it's one of their favorite things. They get to talk about themselves. They don't have to interview you. You want to know about them. So I just take full advantage of that.
I take a course. I take this one test called CareerLeader.com. It's great for business people. It was developed by some people at HBS. And one of the best things they have on there is a battery test. One's one values. And it does this conjoint analysis to figure out what's the, what are your values. You don't change your values. You change your skills, you change your interests, but not your values. And what I realized, what most important thing for value for me was to have control over how I spent my time. And the second thing was influence. And making a huge amount of money was about halfway down the list. So this was very helpful to me doing the internet rush in 99 when all of my friends, it seemed, were making a gazillion dollars by working, you know, huge amounts of hours. I'm like, why don't I quit Forrester and go do that? Because then I realized that Forrester really was the right place for me because it was a really good match with my values.
Hi, my name is Ruby Diol. I'm from SAP, and my question is actually for Gina. Gina, what are the key success factors of your success? If you can name, like, maybe first three that really helped you to make you successful and your company to grow.
Well, I hope from here we're going to be a lot more successful. So I appreciate and flattered that you think that even to this point we've been successful. You know, for me, it is constantly knowing what's important, I think, is the most important thing. But really having a sense of, you know, as I was saying earlier, results matter. You know, the numbers, certainly in the internet world, those are what matter. And for me personally, the kind of product and having a tremendous amount of pride and also being able to use and wanting to use what we were creating and what we have created was a tremendous motivator for me and really has made it feel like this isn't work. I'm my values, to Charlene's point, match the product that I've had the great fortune to be able to help define. And I think, you know, that ability to really understand what's important and go back and constantly check what is important, whether it's for product, whether it's for organization, whether it's to match my values to what I'm doing every day and the things that are important to me and important to the company, those are the things that at least I find have made made me as productive as I hopefully am, and certainly has made my job and my, you know, my life really fun and meaningful and super exciting because I have true passion for bringing software to people that makes, you know, even a small impact in their lives, whether it's, you know, something that allows a nonprofit to organize and connect with each other online, or whether it's a, you know, a totally meaningless, you know, fun, you know, quick hit entertainment thing that people are doing and connecting around. And the fact that I get to work on something that is, you know, fundamentally one product that is being used in so many diverse ways, that to me is just something that I want to dedicate everything I've got to right now, at least.
So we have time for a couple more questions before we wrap up.
Hi, my name is Nancy Kasdan. I'm from Market Share International. It's my company, been running it for 23 years, just the age of my daughter, and who may end up running a small nation one day. I think that one of the important things since I've been an entrepreneur, I've also been overseas for almost 20 years and just come back. I think that the real issue here is not just about male, female, gender, whether we're short, I love that, I have 3 inches of heels on, but I think that the give back and my real issue is giving back to our kids to make them far more successful than any of us are in this room. I cannot begin to say that the work-life balance is tough, there is no doubt, but I think that growing the subtleties And having our kids address the subtleties of what they're going to go through at a very young age, I'm talking like 7, makes a huge, huge difference. And I have to say, after working with lots of CEOs and putting money on the bottom line and investment banking, blah, blah, and techo stuff, when I step back, I believe the most rewarding thing that I've ever experienced is the fact that my daughter is overseas. She hasn't graduated from law school yet. She's working with a Japanese firm. They're from two difficult mergers. And I'm the one that's coaching her because she asked me. I didn't tell her what to do. And with all the intellectual capital that we have, I think our role is not being a mommy, is being a real mentor and a coach to the next generation, whether it's girls or boys or whatever. I just think it's one of the most powerful and empowering things you could ever experience. So although it seems painful sometimes to do the work-life balance thing, when we get there and our kids are on their own doing great things, like all of us are doing and want to do in this room, I think that's when we're really going to start seeing real change. Right? Thanks. Just had to say it. Thank you.
So we have time for one last question, because I promised Gina could get back to work by 9 p.m.
We should go a few more minutes if there are other questions, just because we started late.
Hi, I'm Colleen. I'm from Electronic Arts. And my question was about risk. And I'm curious, what are some of the biggest risks you've faced? And then also, how did you feel or get comfortable with taking some of those risks?
At least for me, I think there might be something wrong, but I never sort of looked at starting a company as a risk. And certainly from my perspective, there have been absolutely, you know, frightening moments of, oh my gosh, I'm going to fail. But at the same time, I found my home in starting something that I could help define. And I'm a second-time entrepreneur. My first startup failed. I mean, you know, we sold it for nothing, basically. And I learned a lot of incredibly valuable lessons. So I actually find one of the things that's really cool about risk is if you're taking risks, you're learning things that you're going to take into your next risk. And the next risk is going to not feel like that scary because you have learned all these lessons and all these things to help mitigate the risk. And risk on some level is fun. I mean, doing something brand new is really cool, even though there are at times a lot of sleepless nights where you're sitting there going, oh gosh, how's this gonna fly? But at the same time, there's other nights that I literally have stayed awake, you know, a year, 2 years, 3 years ago, going to myself, oh my gosh, this is something that is blowing my mind at this moment. So, you know, it's the highs are higher and the lows are lower, but at the same time, you know, I think it, for the right person, it just, you know, focusing in on the lessons that you're taking into the next thing, you know, failure doesn't scare me as much.
Yeah, I think that risk is, if you perceive it as something that's very risky, it means you have more invested in the status quo than not. And that may be appropriate. You know, it may be a financial risk that you can't take at that time, or you don't want to sacrifice balance. You know, one of the reasons why I didn't become a CEO earlier in my career, because I was afraid that I would lose the balance that I had when I had young children. And I stayed at HP for 17 years because I was afraid of that. Now, it turns out, I found out later, that I worked just as hard at HP as I would have at a startup, so I made a mistake there. But that was one of the reasons why I didn't take that risk, because I didn't want to lose. I was more invested in the status quo. And you just have to investigate that balance for yourself and say, am I overly invested in the status quo for some reason that doesn't make any sense? And then take the jump, but it may be appropriate.
Yeah, I mean, some people would argue that I stayed at Forrester for too long because I had a lot of influence, but then I had to write a book to give myself the confidence to say that, okay, you know, I really have some, you know, I really can do this job pretty well. But it was also, I think, an issue of I was in a really nice situation there. It was really comfortable. I knew the job, so I didn't have a lot of risk in the job. I could focus on my family. The riskiest thing I ever did was to tell my parents I was not going to be a pre-med anymore. But then, and I reassured them, like, look, you know, I can type 100 words a minute. If nothing else, I can be a really good secretary. So knowing that, that's what gave me the courage to go do this change now. Because I may not have the same status, have everything the same, but I have enough confidence in my skills that I'll be able to cobble something together.
Well, let's face it, this is Risk Valley. I mean, if you have a big job in this valley, you are going to be asked to size up risk every day, because risk means opportunity. I'm in the business of risk. I'm a venture capitalist. But it also means that you really need to know yourself extremely well. You need to know your inherent strengths and weaknesses. And as Carol said earlier, you need to find where you have unfair competitive advantages, either as an individual, as a team, as a leader. But that is the recipe for success here in this geography. This is Mesopotamia of risk. If you look at risk as a glass half full versus half empty, it will look like opportunity rather than a recipe for failure. One more question?
Eitan Ayalon from Global Tech Research. I met you earlier and a year ago at a conference, and you're going strong, so I'm glad to see that. I wanted to ask, as a founder of a startup myself, and as someone interested in hiring the best talent from anywhere, male, female, whatever country you may come from, whatever your language background is, what kind of advice can you give for making a work environment very friendly to women, whether they're working on the technology side, the content side, or the business side? And I've had the good fortune to work with some really exceptional women. And I try every day, you know, it's not a question of creating an unfair situation, but, you know, trying to think of ways to make the environment really, really conducive to making the best talent feel very comfortable and at home. And I wanted to know what type of advice you can offer for making a good environment for attracting some of the best women out there, because talent is a scarce commodity.
I think it's really important, first and foremost, to create a culture where there are clear values, clear things that are important to you in your company and what you're doing, and then hire people. There's a lot of incredibly talented people out there, but look for what does the person that's sitting across the table from you in an interview, what do they want? What do they like to do? What do they not like to do? And, you know, do we have a good fit for that person with their motivations and their skill set, but also their values? I really like the point that you made, Charlene, around that. So that's, from my perspective, first and foremost, because that's good for you and it's good for them. It's creating sort of a successful situation. I can't necessarily speak to that there's sort of some, you know, specific thing that you have to do special for women. I think for anyone in 2008, you've got to provide them as an employer and as a leader a phenomenal opportunity. And that is the most important thing. And a phenomenal opportunity that matches what they want to do and the kind of work balance that they want to have, or lack of work balance that they want to have. And the flexibility and freedom that good news, bad news about technology is, you know, there was a time and a place where you literally had to sit in front of your computer at your office to get anything done. And today, you know, technology allows for communication and work to be pervasive, but at the same time allows for tremendous flexibility that wasn't there before. So I think every individual is different. I think that, you know, whether you're a man or a woman or from this country or not from this country, understanding what that person needs and focused, you know, in the context of the kind of company and the kind of people that you want to surround yourself with and the kind of culture you want to build is what is the most important thing. And I think, you know, certainly allowing both men and women the freedom and flexibility to kind of create the right opportunity for them with their priorities at that point in time, whether it be family or, you know, producing as much work as they possibly can before they take a sabbatical and go do something else that they're passionate about. It's understanding and customizing on some level the experience for those people in your company that you want to recruit and retain.
I think that last part is really important.
it's only one half the equation to acquire. You have to retain them too. And the CEO of Zappos does a great job of talking about how he hires for culture, and the culture helps retain, and it helps with everything that they do. Zappos differentiates himself on fantastic customer service, where people take the initiative. And so I think the reason why I stayed at Forrester for so long, given so many other opportunities out there, is because of the culture that the CEO set from the very beginning. On the back of our business cards are our company values, 4C2Q1S. And every one of us has to recite these on the spot, literally. The CEO might ask us at any point what those values are. And that is just a driving force, the fact that I can just have a frank conversation and call my CEO on things that I would think he's doing right and have those frank conversations makes the world of difference that I matter as an employee.
But I think there's a common theme in the cultures that are that women feel comfortable in, and that is one that has respect as a fundamental tenet of the culture, and that respect is for everyone, so it applies to men and women and anybody from any country or culture or religion or race or whatever. And it's the CEO that sets what does that mean? You know, how is respect enforced? How is respect encouraged? And it's respect for customers, it's respect for vendors, it kind of goes throughout the entire company, and that, you know, you encourage interpersonal respect and fair treatment and that kind of stuff. And to me, when I was a CEO, that was an ascent, you know, that was a critical feature of the culture and the values, and somehow that had to be pervasive.
Yeah. And I would recommend never having unisex bathrooms either.
We had unisex.
I was at a company today and I realized they were never going to have a woman there. They had one bathroom that had the word unisex on it. So. All right, I'd like to, any more questions? We have one more before Gina has to go back and have her 10 minutes of sushi.
I had it before.
I know you had one.
She gets to ask.
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah.
Just stand up.
Stand up and ask.
And yeah. Bellow.
Bellow.
I'm Laura Marino. I'm with Telvi Microsoft. I had a question actually for Anne. You probably get involved in looking how young companies start building out their management teams and probably helping them get candidates. How frequently do you see actually qualified women candidates come into that mix? And do you see any tendency from those younger companies to either favor or not favor women coming in into their executive positions?
Well, I think there's several questions here. I'm happy to say that there is a growing number of women executives in our portfolio companies and that I see in others. In fact, when we knew that one of our panelists had called in sick, and before we had confirmation that Carol could be trapped into this role, I started saying, well, I've got a lot of women executives in the Hummer Winblad portfolio company, and it was great to make those calls. I called one woman who's VP of Worldwide Sales, very experienced, and she said, gee, I'd love to do it, but I'm working on we have the final negotiations for a $2.5 million deal that's on a time zone tonight. So, you know, that's what I have to do. I called another woman who is a CFO of one of our companies that's about $25 million in revenues. And I had just been at their office, so I knew that she was there. And I'd left there at about 5 after 5. And I called her and I said, hey, you know, you're about 20 minutes away. And she said, yeah, I'm on my BlackBerry, but I'm on mile 5 of my 10-mile run. So by the time I shower, get back, and finish up, so, you know, instead of her 10-minute sushi, she did a 10-minute run. So it was really kind of a gratifying experience to call 5 women executives. And, you know, it wasn't like, gee, you know, sure, I might do this. They all had really high-level, interesting, passionate things. Now, the comment that was made earlier about culture is very, very key. We see hundreds of companies every year, and we fund only companies at the starting line. And there is a big difference between crisply describing your product than describing what culture you're going to build.
And I do find, as Carol has described, that, you know, women executives don't glom on to exciting products. They glom on to exciting companies. And they want to know, is the leader a driver and they're just fearless? You know, are they like Gina, like, yeah, sure, I'm the CEO. Forget this advertising thing. I'm going to run a company. And as you can see from our panelists, none of, you know, Gina, Charlene, and Carol are not afraid to express who they are as well as what they do. And that really is the more that companies really have these unique identities as people, because especially in the software industry, it's all about the intellectual capital, the more it is attracted to women and they know what they're getting into. And I also think that women are very decisive. This question asked early about, you know, how do I find my way? I haven't quite found what I want to do. Well, keep on trying. Just quit your job and go on to the next one, another beauty of this valley. But all in all, I would say that it is a much healthier environment for women, and there are many, many more successful women right now that are, you know, in their roughly, I would say, at the VP level, that are being called out for CEO roles, that, you know, are still only in their early 30s. So they've got long careers ahead, and some of them, you know, even in their 20s. So there was kind of a gap, I think Carol will agree with this, where, you know, there's not a lot of women around in their kind of mid-40s that, you know, that are as aggressive as this next generation of women that are maybe 10 years younger, you know, where they're much, much more confident in expressing who they are as well as just doing great jobs. On that, I'd like to thank our panelists, Gina, Charlene, and especially Carol, for sharing themselves with us tonight.
I'd like to thank you again, Gina, Charlene, Carol, and of course, Anne, ABI, FWENE. Check out the websites. And thank you all for coming, and we will see you at the next meeting of the Churchill Club.